Welcome to Prospecting Purpose, where we explore mining's role in shaping a sustainable, socially just, and brighter future. I'm Liz Friel, your host for the series, with a rotating guest on every episode. Have you ever wondered what we actually mean when we use the word responsible to describe mining? There are countless standards and frameworks, and even Wikipedia has a whole page on responsible mining. But who gets to decide how we define it? Can it be measured? And is there a secret recipe? That's exactly what we're going to focus on today. Joining us on this episode is John Thompson, who, as he puts it, comes right from the rocks. An industry veteran, director, and board member, his impressive 35-year mining industry track record boasts names such as Cornell University, Teck Resources, the World Economic Forum, MineSense Technologies, and the Canada Mining Innovation Council. Welcome, John.
Nice to be on with you.
Great to have you. So the first documented use of the term responsible mining that I could find was in the late 1970s, but it's really only picked up steam in much more recent years, right? So I wanted to ask you, since we started talking about it, have you seen real change during your time in the industry?
So that's a great way to start this discussion, because this term responsible has grown in significance, and yet I don't think we really know what it means. There's lots of little changes, things that are driving mines to be more energy efficient, use less water, work more closely with communities, all things which sound good, but probably don't yet satisfy the use of the word responsible.
Mm-hmm. So what are the key areas that you think make up responsible mining, technically, socially, environmentally, financially?
You know, it starts at the beginning. If we're starting a mine from scratch right now, you obviously want to design it to be, you know, as clean and as efficient as you possibly can. But unfortunately, that's really difficult because we design mines for way out in the future. It takes us 5 to 10 years to turn, you know, a plan into a mine. And that means you're locked in on the design years ahead of actually producing at the mine. And so the world changes and technologies changes. And it's unfortunate that we're very inflexible about how we can incorporate this. And then once you've got that and you've got an operation, obviously energy efficiency and therefore greenhouse gas limits, you know, ideally zero, is something that we all would like to shoot for, but we're not there yet. Effluent, we don't want anything bad leaving in waters, draining out into the environment. So all these pieces have to be addressed. And probably the most significant of these pieces is, what do the people who live around it think about it? And so there's this term that's been around for quite a long time, which I know you're very familiar with, is social license to operate, which in theory is somehow granted by people. And the reality is, it's not a document, it's not a fixture, it's just an acceptance at a moment in time. And a responsible mind, to me, will be one where you never question that the people actually continue to accept it because of the performance and the purpose of the mine and the engagement and the effective communication between the communities and the mine that makes them say, you know what, we like this mine. It's part of our community. It's responsible. And that, at the end of the day, is going to be a metric, which is not a metric.
Well, and therein lies the challenge, right? Historically and even present day, measuring this social element is extremely difficult. And admittedly, that's part of why I wanted to do this. The social license piece is really at the heart of doing business well as we move into the future. And yet it is incredibly difficult to measure, to quantify.
Right. And they have to approve it every day from when it starts until it closes. And even after it closes, in an ideal, responsible mind, it leaves a positive legacy, such that the community looks back and said, you know, that was great, but they left us this and they left us that. And these are all now parts of our lives and businesses, and we benefited from the whole experience. So responsible isn't a moment in time. Responsible is something that's going to be, you know, forever. Well, I'm a geologist. So forever is a very long time for me.
Well, so that's what I was going to say, is that forever is a challenging notion for an industry that is so focused on the life cycle of just the project that we are designing and delivering upon. Yeah. The life cycle is one part of the life of land, the life of community that is impacted by that project. And I would suggest that perhaps part of responsible mining is understanding our role in that bigger picture, in that much larger time frame as well.
Correct. Yeah. As in any industry, you know, they tend to be short term. They have to raise money. They have to get capital to make this mine, to build things and so on. And they're focused on getting a return on that capital that they've invested. So that makes them, you know, quite narrow in their thinking.
Mm-hmm. So what are some of the ways that we commonly fall short in your experience?
Well, a lot of ways. We're an imperfect industry. And that's one of our challenges has been a desire to be below the radar, because we know that we're a challenging industry and we've had problems and historically and even more recently we've had problems, we don't like to raise our head sort of above the parapet and get shot. And that's a huge mistake. I think, increasing our level of transparency, really being out there, helping people understand, taking their questions, listening to their concerns, is fundamental to how we're going to improve.
And by extension, the ability to build genuine trust with folks that we impact.
Absolutely. It is all about trust. And the trust is broken just, unfortunately, in a heartbeat when things go wrong. And so we still have things going wrong. We claim we're doing wonderful things, and then we have a tailings dam that collapses and kills people. And that's just a disaster of unmitigated level, which we should not tolerate as an industry, let alone as a society.
Well, and a single event affects the entire industry as well, right?
Absolutely.
Hence why I think it's so important that we move towards a common understanding of this notion of responsible.
Totally, yeah. To me, the exciting, challenging piece we need is a vision. We need to be able to tell people, what is mining going to look like in 2030, 2040, 2050? What are we shooting for? And that's with the tag of responsible. But what does a responsible mine look like in 2050? Does it have zero emissions? So there's nothing coming out.
Right.
Does it have no waste? And we generate huge amounts of waste, unfortunately, great big mountains, literally mountains of waste in many cases. Can we get to zero waste? So what does it look like? And that comes back to leadership. And we need, in the mining industry, we desperately need leadership who can enunciate that vision and really move the industry towards that vision. We're not going to get there quickly, that's for sure. But without a vision, you don't know what we're shooting for. And I don't hear much of a vision coming out from the industry. But if we can't get to responsible mining, then it's very difficult for us to stand up in front of people and say, we deliver the ingredients of life. We deliver critical materials. We do important things. Well, actually, the mining industry has always done that. We've always delivered materials for society. Ever since we started building walls, we delivered things that people wanted. But that isn't the justification. The issue of short-term thinking, it's very hard for leaders to buy into talking about what we're going to be like in 30 years when they're worried about what the bottom line is going to be in the next month. But that's what you want from leaders. You want leaders who take on the big asks and deliver both the vision and day-to-day results as well.
And have the courage.
It's there. I took my big ask.
It's asking a lot.
Absolutely. It is difficult. And investors are starting to ask those questions of the leaders of the mining industry. And the first it was just questions and so on. But now those questions have turned into pressure, demands for investors, of changes to board members, firing of CEOs even, and demands on you do this in your operation or we'll invest in your company. So that's a stark business case example. If the investment isn't there for our business, we don't have a business.
Absolutely.
So not all investors do that yet, but there's definitely a groundswell of investors who are beginning to place those kind of demands on our level of performance. At the end of the day, money talks, and if the money's not there, nothing's going to happen. So they may drive that, again, this increased level of responsibility.
Absolutely. I think the pool of capital without some kind of environmental social governance strings attached is rapidly decreasing at the moment, which makes this a really timely conversation. So, John, what is it exactly that you think needs to change, and where do our biggest opportunities lie to do so?
I touched on a few of these already. So leadership and organization, I think mining companies need to think a little bit more about how they organize in order to deliver on some of these challenges, particularly around the social governance challenges. Environmental ones are in some ways a little easier in that there are technical things that we can do and data that we can use to assess these things. And then on the sort of technical side, it's driving innovation to solve these the performance questions, which relate then to energy and water and in the environment. We're making progress there. There's some fantastic things happening in the innovation world, and the whole digital transformation that is coming through the mining industry, as it is through everything else we touch. This company that I work with here in Vancouver called MineSense, which is trying to help mines select which material is the good material to mine versus which is the material that's of no value. And by making that choice, the mine is able to focus and be more selective. And as a result, it uses less energy and less water and is more sustainable.
So what do you think some of our biggest impediments will be as an industry?
You know, if we innovate, it's a wonderful thing, but it's not. It tends to be still incremental. And so how do we do transformational change into an industry that's quite conservative, that takes a long time to do things? This design problem again. You know, we design now for something that's going to be 10 years out. So how do we build in flexibility that means we can incorporate, you know, radical changes in technology over that time period, instead of being very fixed in our view of this is how we do it and this is the only way we need to do it. But another big challenge in our industry, because of the complexity, is that we're very siloed. The engineers like to build the mines, the environmental scientists like to make sure the water's clean and so on, and we don't talk very much to each other. And so we need to break down those silos if we're going to really have radical transformational change. Most of the exciting things don't happen in a nice linear way within a silo. They happen on the edge between, you know, disciplines or even between sectors. There's many layers to that question of impediments, and you know, there's no short answer.
Yes, absolutely. And so when you think about the future of responsible mining, what are you afraid of and what excites you?
I'm afraid that the inertia will win, whether it's the lack of leadership or just the problems, the really tough problems of, you know, moving lots of rock, the challenge of making sure it's done, you know, as best we can, but falling short, always falling short. Those are my concerns, that we don't move fast enough for me. I'm impatient. I'm a product of this industry, and I want this industry to be good. I want to be proud of the fact that we deliver critical materials to everybody so that they can have phones and computers and so on. But I want to be proud that we do it in a really, really good way and that other people agree with me. On the opportunity side, you know, because of the complexity and so on, I think there's huge scope for smart people and creative people and interested people to be involved in helping us do this. And we don't have to try and do it all in-house and feel that we're the only ones who understand this. We can reach out to a lot of other people and get them to help us, both on the technical side, but on the environmental side, the social side. I think we need to embrace the fact that we don't own all our problems. We need help on our problems. And you know, young people like to do things that are meaningful. You know, young people today coming out of universities, they want to be involved. So we have a lot of home for and opportunities for people who want to come and solve some really tough issues and then as a result, make the world a better place. But at the end of the day, and this is a fear I have, is that we're in a bubble talking to ourselves. We're with the industry still telling each other that we want to do these good things. And we haven't worked out yet how to tell the rest of the world how we could do these good things. And please, will you come and help us?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I love that. So, John, personally, I spend a lot of time thinking about what our industry's role is in a more sustainable and socially just future. The world's a dark place some days, and I like thinking about a brighter future. You know, the show is called Prospecting Purpose, and I wanted to ask you what purpose means to you in the context of responsible mining.
Purpose for me is sort of, as I said, it's providing critical ingredients that we need to, for humans need to live. And that's not just nice devices and cool toys, which we do tend to like, but it's even basic ingredients like clean water. You know, providing clean water to 2 billion people who don't have it now requires materials, and that requires metals and resources and so on. That's what I want, is us to deliver those materials, but I want to be able to put my hand on my heart and say we do it really well. So I want you to believe that you can trust us in the future, that we can do this and we can deliver it in a way that we will do it with zero harm and zero waste. And you know, we're not there yet, but we are determined as an industry to get there. So we should be part of the solution also on the recycling, the reuse part of the circular economy as well. So the mining industry needs to become integrated into the circular economy. And again, that's another piece of this definition of responsibility, is that we don't just throw things over the fence and say, yeah, we've done our job, we're great. We actually care about what happens to them as they've gone out into the community. We work with the earth, and the earth is our home. It's the only home we've got, and it's exceedingly complicated, the earth. It's made of all these different minerals and different things all over the place, and yet the earth provides these things for us to use. And so we have a responsibility. We're kind of renting space on our planet, and we've got a responsibility to look after it. So we have to be able to say that again, hand on heart, and have people to believe us.
Well, that's all for today's episode. This is Liz Friel on Prospecting Purpose. Thank you so much for joining us, and thank you, John, for being with us today.
Pleasure.
If you want to learn more, check out the show notes for links on all that we covered today. See you next time.